So listen, welcome to Story Club, June 10th, 2021. We've got some great stories today. Story Club is where creators can present their stories and describe the brand integration and sponsorship opportunities. As you participate here, please be sure to mute your audio when you're not speaking. Use the chat to let me know if you have some questions. Please allow the presenters to get through their presentation before we start the Q&A period. And then if you can just alert me in the chat that you have a question, I can go to you then and try to get all the questions in that we can. We have a strict 20-minute timeline. I've got my recorder right here. I'll let you know, Chris, when you're bumping up against 20 minutes. And you know, without any further ado, I'm going to introduce Chris Bren here from Picture Farm. He's got a terrific story that's going to go into production with Mr. Mannion. So Chris, take it away. You can share your screen whenever you're ready, and it's all yours.
Thanks, Rick. I appreciate it. Nice to see everybody, and thanks for inviting us and giving us an opportunity to talk about the content that we're super excited about producing called Blurred Lines. We are currently in production with a terrific series called Black Market, which is distributed by Vice and features Michael K. Williams. We feel that Blurred Lines is certainly not identical to that, but puts us into a storytelling style that we feel is consistent with what Picture Farm is all about. So I think the first thing I'm gonna do is just show a 2-minute video that has Jonathan Mannion, who's the host of the show, present some of the key elements, some of the salient elements of the show, and then I'll introduce the rest of the team right after. So I'll just go for it. Great.
As an artist, you are signing up for a set of challenges that you don't know yet. Being an artist requires a ton of bravery. You may not know it, you may just walk into it and you're gonna realize quickly how hard this is. Like, one, to make the work, two, to be consistent, three, to be dedicated, four, to not be taken off your square, five, to be able to pay for it, the art, six, to be able to pay for your life and eating. Like, people are selling paintings to live. But I think that, you know, the guts of this show is really to speak to the people that are in it right now, that are really chasing their dreams right now in real time. How did you get there, and how did you succeed, and how did you just take off and you're in outer space? Is it good enough? Does it matter? Am I the right person to make it? Is it important? Self-doubt, the vulnerability. All of these things, man, are human characteristics. So even if you hate art entirely, come for the human story, come for the struggles, come for the pain, come for the, if I don't sell this painting, I'm not gonna eat. And I'm trying to connect with that individual and tell stories that are for the betterment of humanity, to become more connected, to become more understanding of each other. Who are the brilliant voices of this generation that are defining how the world sees? And that's what Blurred Lines is to me.
All right, so that just gives you a little hint of what Jonathan Mannion's like and a bit of his character, but the fact is I just happen to work here, and I'd rather just introduce you guys to really the executive producers and the creatives who are behind it, who can speak about everything much more clearly. So I'd like to introduce you to Ben Friedman, Dion Sapp, and Carrie Laster. Take it away, Carrie.
Sure. Thank you so much, Chris. So Blurred Lines is a documentary series that's really centered around dealing with the this generation of creators that are pushing the, you know, pushing the boundaries on art, pushing the boundaries on what it means to be an artist, what it means to live in the world and create. This kind of all started from living here in New York. I live in Brooklyn, and I'm walking down the street and I see this beautiful mural. I'm in Bushwick, beautiful mural. And I see the kid painting it. And I'm like, I don't know who you are. This work is incredible. Why are you doing this? Why are you here slaving over this, putting everything you have in it for your tag? Your picture's not on it. There's no guarantee that you're gonna make a living out of this. There's no guarantee that you're gonna be famous. But here you are putting your work on the side of these buildings, on, you know, on the street, on these, you know, stop signs. Like, what is the motivation for that? And that led to other conversation with, you know, more traditional contemporary artists, and asking them, like, why are you doing this without the promise of it actually working out for you? And it became a story about inspiration. It became this whole bigger project about journey, self-discovery, you know, passion, about dedication. And in this series, we are going to be focusing on different artists and diving into their world, finding out how they went from the start of it, where that first injection of hunger happened, to how they got to this present moment now. You know, how do you get from painting on the side of walls in the middle of the street to being in the Met, you know, to being on, you know, the side of MoMA? Like, how does that happen? And then what does that do to your psyche? You know, how does it change you when people all of a sudden say the thing that you were doing for free has value? And then what does that mean when that doesn't happen for you? And, you know, how do you translate these things? And this series is really taking a dive into that world, because there isn't another series that's really unpacked like the art world from the artist's perspective, and seeing the inner working of it and the challenges and, you know, and what goes into that. There's always the pretty side of it that we see in galleries, but there's the other layer of the people who make this. And who are those tastemakers? Who are the Picassos? Who are the, you know, the Rembrandts that we don't know exist right now, because they're in Brazil painting on the side of their favelas? You know, this is the journey that we kind of take viewers on. And we do this with, you know, Jonathan Mannion, who is an icon and legend when it comes to shooting photography, and the covers, all the series of iconic album covers and artists that he's worked with. He's covered most of hip hop. If you just look at his, you know, catalog of work, and he has a real good nature in unpacking, you know, truth and journey with like artists and individuals and creatives. And we're capturing some of that on camera, in addition to getting into their work and their process and, you know, taking you into like how they create. So that's a good bit of the heart of the series, and driving this question of why. Why are you doing this? Why are you sacrificing? Why are you hungry for this? Where does it come from? You know, and what moves you? The other parts of this, you know, journey, the other parts of this project that we saw organically that just spurred out were, you know, taking the conversation past just the 1 hour, you know, series, the 1 hour episode, and getting into like the podcast, which extends that conversation even further to other creatives. And then also getting into our live events that, you know, we're taking the artists that we are collaborating with, and Jonathan is also creating unique work with them with photography, and us doing some like exhibits and doing some live activations with this work being featured with them, and inviting other artists that, you know, we feel like are in the area that we want to promote, because again, this is an international show. So we're not just going to be here in the States. We're not just going to be in Brooklyn. We're going to be in Tokyo. We're going to be in Brazil. We're going to be taking you to Italy. We're going to be showing you all of these different flavors of life, all of these different creators who are creating work that is meaningful and different and fresh. And in that same spirit, we want to create activations and experiences in each one of these markets to have people come and see the art, exchange, you know, creatively, be able to, you know, spark ideas. The podcast is that extension of it, where we can get deeper and do deeper dives into it. So if we want to get a little bit more academic, if we want to unpack things a little bit further and slower, we can do that in there. In addition to obviously us wanting to, you know, compile things like a book, because he is a photographer, because we're going to be documenting, you know, a lot of these experiences, they're just become all these organic offshoots that we want to, you know, take this series in. So aside just from the digital series that we're seeing on, you know, your traditional streaming platform network. We also get into the, you know, online social extensions that we start to, you know, partner with other artists that aren't featured there. We get into our podcast that becomes further unpackings of different, you know, conversations and topics that are in this world. And then we get into the actual experiences themselves that we create with, you know, these different exhibits and actual events that we would facilitate in a variety of different cities and locations to feature other artists, you know. But the main driver is, how do we tap into the next group of creatives, and how do we, you know, be at the forefront of that conversation more than, you know, the feeling that happened with Chef's Table, you know, when all of a sudden we went chef crazy and everybody was trying to feel like, how could I get my hand on the chef? You know, it's like this becomes that next opening of, let's talk about artists, you know, let's show people who have beautiful work, who make beautiful things that inspire us in post-culture, and let's start to tell their stories, you know. And then it becomes even more interesting when you start getting into the celebrity component of people like Jim Carrey, who's a painter, who has a whole studio where he just paints. You know, you get into all of these other people who are like, oh, I love this. It isn't my main thing. It isn't what I get paid to do, but it's what I have a passion for. And if I could do this every day, I'd want to do it. And then you have the others who are like, this is it. I'm not making any money, but I love it. And I'm in this, you know.
Hey, Carrie, just one question is, how do you see integrating maybe the artist's work, not just by documentary capture, but in that video that we just showed, there's all this great animated work, and there seems to be like sort of sky's the limit in terms of how you want to creatively tell the story just from a visual perspective. I mean, what are some of the thoughts on that?
So some of the thoughts there, and that really gets us into the digital component of it and the companion pieces. There's a lot of animated explorations because, again, we're talking about street artists in one component. You can talk about contemporary, but then you also get into the digital animators and the illustrators and the work that they create that also is informing the way we process brands. For example, you have the Oscars, which recently collaborated with the artist, you know, Timmy Cocker out of Texas, and he completely painted the Oscars. You know, that ability now for the brands and institutions and, you know, places that we are familiar with integrating with individual artists as opposed to just agencies also becomes more fascinating. And then being able to take their brush and influence even more than, you know, we could imagine. So that part of the digital companion pieces of this would unpack some of those things as well through, you know, visual elements such as illustrators, animators, you know, you get into your 3D artists that are also pushing the limits on what is possible, especially as we move into like holograms and things. So it becomes this whole other thing of like, what does it mean to be an artist? What does it mean to really do this? Why do you do this? And, you know, let's get into the journey of it and find that common thread of like passion, expression, and dedication.
Awesome.
Chris, I tried to condense it. I tried to condense it, Rick.
Carrie, that is, I mean, this is a big, aggressive campaign. It seems like a huge production with, you know, international and live events and exhibits and podcasts and website. It's very exciting. I've got questions myself. If anybody wants to jump in, do so.
Yeah, I actually have a question.
Yeah, go, John.
So, you mentioned Chef's Table, which is a fabulous show to get sort of digs down below and obscure chefs from all over the world. Are you interested in doing, so the content that you want to create, is it an episodic show like that? It's half hour, 40 minutes, hour long, and it's ongoing. It travels the world. Is that the idea?
That is the idea. Is the idea. It would be that kind of ongoing journey. The beautiful thing about art is there's so much that people don't know. There's so many figures that people aren't aware of. And if they do know them, it's like, I kind of know your name. I'm not familiar with you. And kind of, you know, if we're doing that comparison to process, a chef's table unpacks these people that are creating taste. So, you know, who are the people who are affecting our visuals? And that would be what we'd want to do.
Yeah, and Jonathan Mannion's access is tremendous because his reputation is certainly in that community is second to none.
Well, for what it's worth, I would say from my perspective, like a lot of the stories that I find most interesting are the people who are talented, who are not successful. It's like they haven't happened yet. Those were the ones you kind of go, what's going to happen there? The people who have arrived, that's, you know, David Hockney, great. Mm-hmm. It's like those people that they live, like you said, favela, like that person who lives there, who's painting on the side, like, and then all of a sudden that's money. That is just gold from a storytelling perspective.
Yeah.
How many artists never gain fame until after they die? You know,
all of them.
Yeah.
Right? Long list.
Talk to us a little bit about, you know, what do you envision for brand participation, integration mm-hmm. opportunities, sponsorship? Is it a exclusive brand? Is anybody on board now? Talk to us about the brand involvement.
Sure. I'll talk a little bit about, you know, where we're looking for that integration. It becomes in our digital series companion pieces. So the stuff that, you know, becomes online social series that we do for the YouTubes, the Facebooks, it becomes our actual live activations, which include, us doing exhibits, touring gallery shows. It becomes the podcast series that we develop. It becomes when we're getting into the actual print component. So when you start talking about developing, the book, printed materials. It also becomes, you know, sponsorship and things like the Art Basel's activations. And we're at a lot of these bigger, more established, like the Art Basel's, the powwows in Hawaii, a lot of these bigger art scene moments. And being there, featuring some of the artists that are in our series, as well as having like a bigger, you know, integrated section activation at these different things. But I know that, you know, Chris and Ben can also speak to where we are with other collaborators and, you know, brands that we're in talks with as well.
You want to go ahead, Chris?
Yeah, Ben, I don't know if you want to pick up on that.
Yeah, I was going to jump in and say, yeah, in terms of the core of the programming, that the intention is to go with a traditional streamer. It would be a Netflix and Amazon, this kind of thing, to carry the main programming. There's room always for a brand to participate in that, just in terms of, you know, contributing to some of the budget on that. But broadly, as Kerry says, we see it because there's such a big 360 aspect to this, that there's such a big piece of this which can happen outside of the core programming in it, that it's the perfect territory for a brand to be involved.
So I'll ask you this. This is an international program, so you're going to be doing activations in Asia and Europe and elsewhere. And are the brands that you're pursuing, any brand participation, would they need to be a global brand?
I mean, I don't think so necessarily. If you have somebody who's strong in a territory, then that could be a conversation that you have about that territory. If you have a big global brand who wants to sort of have the umbrella of the thing, then sure, that would be great. But I don't think it's exclusive in any way.
Yeah, but a Diageo, you know, might find a way, you know, to do something, you know, across a variety or a singular alcohol brand within their family. Which is a global situation. So a global opportunity is certainly ideal, but anything can be parsed out in this day and age, as we all know.
We have, I'll give you the 2-minute warning right now. Anybody else that we haven't got to that like to ask a question, go ahead and unmute and dive in. Okay, then I will keep going.
Well, I'll make one quick point to Ben. I would say that you may want to consider, I spent a lot of time in this space, starting it outside of the US might be an interesting thing to do as well, and then bringing it here, because it's going to give you more leverage coming back to the United States with respect to the streamers.
Okay.
If that's your goal. I would think about that.
Yeah, great advice. Thanks.
Kerry and Chris, what's the timeline like? When have you started production yet? Have you selected artists? You know, when's this all start?
Carrie?
Chris? Okay. I don't ever want to talk over. We have started already with selecting artists. We've already started a conversation to start securing them in. And, you know, hopefully we'll be going into production in the next few months. Is that when we're looking to like try to activate on things? And it's just now all conversation, which is why we're here, to try to like see if we can find the right partner from the beginning and figure out even more organic, infused partnership, where places that brand can inspire us with us creating certain, you know, assets or the way that we approach the content. And, you know, how can we further flesh out these offshoot components to the series to make it, you know, more organic and drive it and be more special and unique? Because again, this is uncharted territory. So we want to really make a splash coming fresh out the gate. There is no series that we're competing with. There is no, you know, there isn't something that's just like this that we point to. So that idea that we're coming first out the gate, that we're coming out with something unique and powerful, and we have the artists to really do it, becomes very interesting. So
I'm just going to say, I think it's brilliant. And I think that there's got to be so many terrific stories out there with struggling artists who can't help but create, right? They can't help but create their art. Their whole life is driven by, you know, putting paint on a wall or whatever it might be. So really looking forward to this. So one more question, final question for you, because we're going to hit 20 minutes here. Whose idea was this? Where did this come from?
Raise your hand, Carrie.
Nice. Yeah. It came from the story I told you. It came from literally seeing artists making work in New York and asking them why you're doing this.
I absolutely love it. Thanks for sharing, you guys.